chapter number 37. Genesis chapter number 37. And I will read a few verses of scripture, and I'll be out of your hair. Incidentally, while you're turning, they put the basket. That's fine. While you're turning, they put the basket in the back. Amen. Amen. And so, in the front. Right here. Yep. So I won't trip over. And you can put those pledges there. Amen. And there's letters that you can send, that the admin team can send you, so that you can give to others if you have anybody else in mind that you want to pass one out to. Amen. I won't be talking about that for long, but amen. If you have your Bibles, Genesis chapter number 37, and I am going to rest right around verse number 6. Verse number 5, actually. Genesis 37, verse number 5. And when you have it, I want you to stand for the reading of the word. Amen. I'll talk to you for just a second. Hallelujah. If you get a chance, I want you to read the words to that song. Amen. I may read them to you at some point. Genesis chapter number 37, verse number 5. And it says, now Joseph had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. And he said to them, hear this dream that I have. Behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and stood upright, and behold, your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf. And his brother said to him, are you indeed to reign over us? Or are you indeed to rule over us? So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. And then he dreamed another dream and told it to his brothers and said, behold, I have dreamed another dream. Behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me. But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said to him, what is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brothers indeed come to bow ourselves to the ground before you? And his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept these sayings in mind. I'm going to pray, but I'm going to talk to you for this subject of my pain is for his purpose. Father, I thank you. God, you said in your word that all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. And so, God, we believe you, God. We speak life over every word that is said. God, let the hearer hear what you are saying. We bless you. We praise you. We honor you, God. Speak, God. We're all listening. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can be seated. You can be seated. I won't be before you long. I wanted to talk to you for a minute. Because sometimes we are making assumptions about several things as it relates to God. How many of you know that oftentimes God will give us something in the beginning so that it will give us the endurance and the strength to go through to the end? God gave Joseph a dream, and God began to deal with Joseph about greatness. And how many of you know that anytime God begins to speak to you about something, it always comes at a price at times. Now, I know Jesus paid the price of it all, but the Bible also says that we were crucified with Christ. And I need to tell you that God sometimes, if you really listen to the verses of that song, let me just read them to you for just one quick second so you'll hear what this brother was saying. He says, falling apart and tearing at the seams, Tribulation lends a hand and squeezes all your hopes and dreams. You say you'll retreat. You say you just can't win. But before you let your circumstances tell you how the story ends, his word says you can stand. And he'll cover you with his grace. Everything you need is in your hands. So lift up your heads and say, all things are working for me, even things I can't see. Your ways are far beyond me. But you said that you would. Let it be for my good. So I rest and just believe.
Amen.
And it's interesting that God sometimes will allow circumstances and situations and things to bring us to a point and a place where we do that. Because God sometimes, I understand what people are saying about God, but if I could always understand God, I'm not really sure that I would serve him. Because God sometimes would do some strange things to you. Check this out. Do you know he did something really, it was strange to Moses. God told Moses, God said, you go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. You know, they would say, let my people. And we say stuff like that, and it sounds really good what he's saying after you've heard about it later on.
Right.
But how many of you know that God told Moses to go to the most powerful man in the known world and tell him to let a group of free worker slaves go? How'd that work out for you? And Moses made a profound statement that he bothered me when he did that. God ignored him. Moses said, God, what would be the sign that you told me to go see Pharaoh to let these people go? Mm-hmm. Watch this. God, you kind of irritated me. I had to talk to God about this. I said, God, I understand. You got to help me. God told Moses this. God says, when you get there, check this out. He says, what would be the sign if you told me to let these people go? That they're Pharaoh. They go see Pharaoh. God says, after you have gone to talk to Pharaoh, when you get to this mountain, you will worship me from this mountain. Am I the only one with a problem? He asked God for a sign now. God, you know, what would be the sign that you sent me to Pharaoh? Pharaoh could have killed him. Pharaoh could have did anything. He says, when you get there, you'll worship me from this mountain. God told him that the sign will be that when he's obedient and he's done what he's told him to do, that when he gets way over here, that they'll worship him from this mountain. So the proof that he's supposed to do it, he'll see it after he's already done it. The confirmation that he's supposed to move will come after he's already been obedient.
Wow.
He could say, look, Pharaoh will give you $2 when you get there. You know, just he'll do this, he'll do that. But no, he says, after you've done what I told you to do, when you get what I told you were going to get, that's going to be your proof. So move along and be obedient. And it's an interesting thing that God oftentimes gives a sign of obedience after we've already done what it is that he's called us to do. Mm-hmm. So in the middle of while we're dreaming, God gives us a dream, and then God will tell us that the proof will be that when we get here, we'll receive what he said.
Wow.
So God told it to Joseph, and God gave Joseph several dreams. And Joseph told it to his brothers, but the thing that God didn't tell Joseph, and maybe that's one of the reasons why God does it that way, is because he told him what he would receive, but he didn't tell him what he would have to go through to get it.
Uh-huh.
Oftentimes, God places things and people and stuff in between what he told you and what he gave you. Mm-hmm. There's a whole lot of mess. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the pain, sometimes the things that come on you while you're see, God will tell you, well, you're going to get this, but he didn't tell you all these people are going to turn on you. Joseph's brothers, they sold him into, they actually took this brother, stripped him of his clothes, and threw him in a pit. They threw him in a pit. Then when the pit came, and everybody, and they were like, we got to kill him now. We got to kill him. How many know that sometimes the people that are closest to you don't even want to see you grow up? Here's the reason why. Because when you begin to walk into things of God, you being faithful to God will convict them on what they're supposed to be doing. Sometimes, whenever you go for God, it reminds them of what they're supposed to be doing. So sometimes people don't want to see you move for God because it reminds them of how short they're falling. I tell leaders all the time, if you live at table level, it gives other people permission to live underneath the table. Okay. And so a lot of times people will pull you underneath the table because it gives them an excuse not to walk right. Wow. And so what happened was Joseph is in this situation where he winds up, his brothers throw him in the pit. Now they got to kill him because they can't go back to his daddy because he knew he was going to tell it because he already told everything out. So they said, oh, we got to kill you now. But then all of a sudden, what wound up happening was they brought some people over and some foreigners began to come. And the foreigners came and they said, you know what? We ain't got to kill them. Let's just sell them into slavery. Mm-hmm. Sell them into slavery. And so some of the same people that you trusted sold you out. Mm-hmm. See, I got to tell you that just because somebody is standing beside you, that don't mean they're standing with you. Mm-hmm. And some of the very people that's supposed to have your back, they sold him into slavery, and now here he is, the promised son, mm-hmm. the favorite one. Sold up the river. And now he's in slavery, and the Bible records that they put him in jail. And when they put him in jail, the Bible says that everything began to go on wrong with him, and the Bible even speaks of a cupbearer, and the Bible says that there was another brother who was in jail because he stole something. It's interesting that you can find yourself having done nothing in the same place with people who did everything wrong. Mm-hmm. But how many of you know that maybe it wasn't for you? Mm-hmm. It was for them that God sent you there.
Wow.
And so while Joseph was in prison, two brothers was in there. One was stealing, one wasn't stealing. You know, folks get five-finger discount in the heartbeat. And the Bible says that Joseph was able to do some things, and Joseph was able to speak, and Joseph was able to set one of the brothers free. Now, the other one got executed because he had did wrong. But Joseph was able to set him free. And the brothers, just like everybody else always do, I'll never forget you for what you did for me. I'll never forget you. Me and you, us never part. And you know what wound up happening? As soon as the burden got off of him, he forgot about Joseph and left him to rot in jail. He got promoted, and Joseph stayed. How many of you know that, but don't be dismayed. Sometimes the very people that you help, God will use you to help them in their situation so that when they raise up. Now, he forgot about Joseph for a long time, but it came a time when his neck was on the line again, and he was like, oh, yeah, I remember this brother named Joseph. Man, the Spirit of God was on him. But where he at? Oh, I left him in jail a long time ago. You left that man? Yeah. Okay, but go get him. Joseph went and got the man. And now Joseph is working for the chief executioner. How many of you know that even if your situation and circumstances try to hold you back, God will still see to it that your gift will make room for you.
That's right.
That your anointing, your favor will take you before kings. Your favor will take you before queens. Your favor will get you places and get you into situations. Your favor will open the door, but your integrity has to keep you there.
That's it.
Hear me. Because when Joseph got in that door, he began to work for Potiphar. Potiphar was a rich man, but what most people didn't realize was Potiphar was the chief executioner. Mm-hmm. Potiphar did this on 22nd Street. Many people died on 44th Street. Potiphar was the man. Potiphar was like, hey, why are you still breathing? And so it was. That's how he rolled. And so Potiphar had a wife, and the Bible speaks of his wife being good looking. And what happened was Potiphar and Joseph, you know, because he had the favor of God on him. How many of you know men of God? The favor of God can be attractive, right? When you got the favor of God, you ain't got to be the cutest fellow in the world. If you learn how to get God's attention, I'm telling you, God's favor will take up for a little bit, will take off a little bit of ugliness. I'm telling you. God's favor, listen, hear me. Hear me, brothers. You want to be fine as Denzel? Get the favor of God in your life. I'm telling you. Sister, I don't know what it is about that brother. He cross-eyed and everything, but there's something about him. He looks good to me. I don't know. Why? Because it's the favor of God on your life. They don't want you. They want the favor. They don't even understand why they like him. I don't know why. Like, he corny, but he cute. I don't know. There's something about him. He's just that favor on his life. I don't know. Maybe it's that every time I get close to him, I feel something. Feel God on that brother. I don't know. But hey, listen, ladies. Bow legs and good looking don't do what it used to do, I'm telling you. I know, I took a sidetrack. Listen. If you want to find a brother, a show enough brother, ladies, listen to little sisters. Stop looking for all these good-looking brothers. I'm telling you, the good-looking brothers, what happens if their face gets scratched up or something happened to them or them little bowlegs get broke or something like that? And they ain't got nothing no more. Listen, y'all listen, y'all listen. Find you a brother who got the anointing riding on his back. Find you a brother who got character, who got the favor of God on. Look, you take care of the looks. I don't know where I'm going. You take care of the looks part, okay? All right, I'm cute enough for both of you. Tell them I'm cute enough for both of us. All right, you got the favor of God on you. As long as you stay right with God, you're all right for me. Listen, because I'm telling you, when that brother, if something happened to that brother and them looks ain't there no more, the anointing will still keep you, girl. I'm telling you. I'm telling you. Listen. Fellas, since I'm on this topic, find you a woman that can get a prayer through. I'm matchmaking. Find you a woman of God who can get a prayer through. Listen, hips, lips, and fingertips, it ain't gonna carry you for long, I'm telling you. Because when that perfect size figure 2 becomes a size 76, you better find somebody who can pray. You hear me? You better find, listen. I'm almost done with this part. But you better find somebody who can pray, who can show enough, get a prayer through. That when heaven needs to be opened up, you need to find you a sister who in a closet. Girl, what is it? First time I saw my wife in the closet, what is you? Oh, okay. Go ahead. That's cute, though. I'll be honest. I'm feeling you on that one. We go shopping later. Praying up. Look, in the closet, praying. I ain't know what she was doing in the closet. She was in there. I thought she was looking for shoes or something, but she was in there praying. She was calling on the name of the Lord. But anyway, so listen. Find you somebody who can get a prayer through. Amen. We got that? I close that chapter? All right. So listen. Listen. Stop looking for all this crazy stuff. Because when the money and all that stuff wear away, you got a woman or a man of God who can be, who has integrity and who can build with the Lord, amen. Everything else take care of itself. I'm telling you. Amen. You can come back 3, 4, 5 times from something.
That's right.
I close that chapter. All right. So listen. Here we go. So anyway, so Joseph got to Potiphar's wife. She's dragging on him, right? She's pulling on his clothes and see all that stuff because she wanted him, right? Because everybody wants the anointing. But Joseph was like, no, you're not mine. I got to walk in integrity. I can't have nothing that ain't mine. And so because you're not mine, you belong to him, I'm going to take care of you like you're his wife. And so even if I got to run, their brother ran out of the house, I ran out of his clothes. But how many of you know that she still accused him of rape? And so having integrity sometimes, remember I told you your character can get you in a place, but your integrity is what's got to keep you there. Your integrity and your and everything that you get from God got to keep you there. And so Joseph, he did it, and they put him back in jail anyway. Mm-hmm. How many know that he got put in a predicament for doing what was right? Mm-hmm. But God had a plan for it. Mm-hmm. God had a plan for it. And so while he's locked up in jail, it ain't enough that you in jail because of the chief executioner. And the crazy thing was, I'm going to tell you how I know this, and you can read the story, I'm covering a lot of chapters at once, because I'm trying to get somewhere. The crazy thing is, the whole while his brothers is back in back home tricking, doing all kind of crazy stuff. But how many of you know? Joseph locked up. Potiphar locked this man up. And the crazy thing was, Potiphar locked him up, the chief executioner, but he didn't kill him. That's how I know he knew Joseph was innocent. Because if you got the power to kill a man at will, and you tell me somebody slept with your wife, or your wife say somebody raped her, why would you throw him in jail and that's it?
That's good.
I can't even tell you. But listen. So he had Joseph locked up in jail. But Pharaoh had a dream. See, again, your gift, your character, your anointing will make room for you. There are some people who did you wrong. And the only reason why they hadn't came and got you yet is because it's not beneficial yet. Because they don't need your gift yet. God sometimes will hide you in places until the opportune time comes. And so what wound up happening was, check this out, y'all. Pharaoh had a dream. He had a horrible dream. He had a dream and then all kinds of stuff. He had a dream about cows and about goats and they were all skinny, different stuff like that. And so he said, oh my God, he woke up having a nightmare and he said, I need somebody to interpret this dream. Potiphar said, you know what? I got a dude I locked up a long time ago. I know he ain't sleeping with my wife, but I locked him up. I did him wrong. See, how many of you know that when you walk in integrity with God, no matter what other people do to you, say about you, lie on you, do whatever, sooner or later, God is going to see to it that the same people that did you wrong and threw you in a pit and dug up your and dug you and did all that other stuff, they're going to have to come right back around and dig you up because they won't be able to go any step further without you. Listen, listen, listen. Let me tell you a secret. I'm going to tell you a secret real quick. Ladies, listen. This one's free. This one's free. All right, check this out. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but it's free. Look, when God do you wrong, don't fuss. Don't do nothing. Don't do all that. Don't bust the windows out of the car. No jabbing soul. Don't do all that stuff. Listen, the worst thing you can do to a guy, just be grateful. That's how it is. You'll miss me before I miss you. Let him watch your head get smaller. Let me tell you what he'll do. He'll watch you for months to see if you're happy again. Once you get happy again, he's going to wonder who made you happy. No, really, I'm serious. See, and then he's going to look at you. He's going to wonder who made you happy. He's going to watch it. He's going to watch it. He's going to watch it. And then the next thing you know, when he sees you getting happy and he see everything, he's going to... And then he's going to start realizing what he missed. By then, he's going to realize that he done traded hamburger in for meatballs or steak in for meatballs. He's going to realize that and he's going to start looking for you. No, really, I'm serious. I know it sounds crazy. So I apologize for the crazy sound and stuff. But listen, one of the worst things you can do, ladies, to somebody is keep your integrity and keep your presence. Keep the presence of God. No matter how bad it hurts, keep your dignity, knowing that you are a king's daughter.
Right.
Listen, and if you don't want, and if you want to fall instead of a princess, let him watch your head get smaller. Listen, I told a young lady the other day, never let a man tell you he don't want you more than once. I know, I'm meddling. I apologize. That was the Holy Spirit. Didn't know I was going there. Not in the notes, not in anything. Had to say that to somebody. I don't know. Maybe I'm saying it to somebody on the internet. But anyway, whoever that's for, have a nice day with it. Listen. Something's wrong, man. Okay, so listen. So anyway, for Joseph, back to Joseph. Some of the same people that did you wrong are going to have to come back and acknowledge who you are. And not only who you are, but whose you are. So they dug him up. Joseph becomes now. I don't know if I told you this, but the whole time Joseph is a foreshadowing of Christ. Because here's what happened to Joseph. When Joseph rose up and told Pharaoh about the famine that was going to come, because that was the interpretation of the dream, that there was a famine coming in the land, and that he said, this is what you ought to do about it. This is what you should do about the famine. We're going to put stuff aside. We're going to have people come and do this. It's going to be great. We're going to do this. And so you need to find somebody that's wise to do it. Joseph told Pharaoh the answer, and then step back like he wasn't going to do it. And then Pharaoh said, you know what? You're going to be the man. You're going to do it. This brother went from being one of the children of Israel to being thrown in a pit and left for dead to being dug up to being all these other things to now he's second in charge of all of Egypt. And this is what he said. Pharaoh said, I'm going to give you a name that's above every name. The name I'm going to give you is called Zaphnath-Phinehas, and that name means the Savior with us, or the Revealer of Secrets. Mm-hmm. See, how many of you know that in whatever place you're meant to be, you're meant to be a foreshadowing of Christ? And there are a lot of people who may use you, they may talk about you, they mistreat you, but I'm telling you, some of them, you are going to be the only part of God that they're going to see, and if they don't see you right in your right place, they'll never be able to reach God.
Wow.
Some of them are watching you right now because you're on fire, and they don't even understand that they're watching the burning bush. And the proof that there is a God is that they're going to see you burning up and you're not being consumed.
That's good.
The proof that you are right with God is going to be that they did you wrong and they don't even look like they're faithing you.
Mm-hmm.
The proof is going to be you may be in a bad place, they throw you in a jail, you make the jail look better than the penthouse.
Mm-hmm.
The proof is going to be that all things work together for them who love God and are called according to his purpose. Have you ever considered that maybe some of the pain that you're going through or that you went through is for the sole purpose for you to talk to somebody for a few minutes and see them delivered? Have you ever considered that maybe what you're going through is not for you, but it's so for somebody else who's weaker than you who may not survive what you're going through? I watched my niece several weeks ago. She had gone through one of the worst times of her life. And it was hard for her to, it was hard for her to keep her head up. But God kept her.
Yeah.
And a few months later, I saw her sitting right over there, and she was talking to a young lady, and she wrapped around her arms around a young lady, and she don't even know what she dealt with, but she delivered that young lady, and she kept that. She went through just to talk to somebody for 2 minutes and see them delivered.
Amen.
How many of you know that sometimes your pain is for a purpose?
Yeah.
Everything that you've been through is for a purpose. Everything that you go through is for a reason. You see, because here's the thing that God does sometimes. Here's the thing that God does sometimes. God will come up to you, and God will get you to a place where the things that are hurting you, God will find you in a place. And that place that God finds you may be rough. Are you hearing me? It may be tough for you. And it may seem like the whole world is against you. How many know when God calls you, God calls you. God calls you for a purpose. And so what God does is God will walk up to you and he'll do this. And God will touch you right where you are. Not where you pretend to be. Not where you're going to be in a few minutes. But God will touch you. And Paul said this. He said, and I talk about this sometimes because this is what happened to me on a regular basis. God said, I must apprehend that which is apprehending me. And so sometimes you can be in a situation where you're hurt, where you got pain, where you got things going on, and God will meet you at your point of destitute, and he'll love you, and he'll tell you just a little bit about where he's calling you to go. See, but if God were to tell you the whole story right then, some of us would turn and run away. How many in this room have ever had a vision or a dream about going somewhere? And when you started going on that way there, you didn't realize it was going to cost you that much. But how many of you know you got to pay the price? You got to step. You got to pay the price. And so what God will do sometimes is God will begin to step away from you. See, but it's during this time where we think that God has left us. We think that God has left us. But see, if you notice what she's doing, and I walked away, she's starting to follow my voice. And so God will move. God will move. Stop. And see, sometimes what the enemy does is the enemy will set obstacles in front of you. And so what he'll do is, God will say, child, I know you love me, but I want you to follow my voice. Come slow. Now I want you to stop. And see, when we get to the point where we begin to follow God's voice and not begin to follow anybody else's voice.
Kaya! Kaya! Kaya!
Can you hear me? But see, because what she has to do is she has to decide whose report she's going to believe. Is she going to go the wrong way? Or is she going to listen? Because see, if she doesn't listen, she's going to run into a lot of obstacles. She may get hit with some things. But the Bible says, but the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And so one of the things that a weapon that she had to use is she had to use her ear and her heart. And she had to learn to follow me. And so I may touch it every now and then. But I want you to step forward. I want you to duck. Get down. And see, some of us have missed things. And we don't even know we missed them. Because we're following the voice of the Lord. Yeah, we may get hurt sometimes. But we're following the voice of the Lord. There may be distractions. There may be distractions.
Kaya, where are you going?
There may be things that people are pulling you back. People are trying to call on you. People are trying to get you to do other things. There may be things, but as long as you continue to follow my voice. Can you hear me?
Kaya, what you doing?
Kaya, you're beautiful. And no matter what happens, you're mine. All the things that happened to you in the past, I was guiding you. And though some of them may have hurt you a little bit, they were for your good, but for my glory. And if you follow me, I'll make sure that you're taken care of. Come with me, Kaya. Kaya, just ignore the noise around you. And just keep following my voice.
Kaya!
Stop. I want you to turn this way. Turn to your left. Walk over a little bit. Step forward. See, because
Sometimes, stop. The things that God is telling you to do, face me. Follow my voice. Find my voice. And see, sometimes it can be frustrating. Come forward. Sometimes it can be frustrating. But you can't see what God has in mind. Stop. I want you to turn left. Not that far left. Come on, follow me. Follow me. I want you to stop. Turn. Lift up your hands. Put your hands down. I want you to just stay right there. See, sometimes you have to ignore some of the things that are trying to hold you back. Mm-hmm. I need you to hear me when I say that. Because God said, for I know the plans that I have for you, plans to give you a hope and a future and an expected end. You see, the crazy thing is, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 47, later on, Joseph's brother, there's a famine comes up in the land. Y'all can see it. There's a famine that comes up in the land. Just stand right there. I got you. There's a famine that comes up in the land. And what winds up happening is, through all the pain, through all the everything, the famine comes in the land, and they hungry, can't nobody buy nothing. And the Bible says that Israel sent their sons to see Joseph. And long story short, they go to see Joseph. Joseph goes, put them through a series of tests. And the crazy thing is that when they get there, they don't even realize who Joseph is. And Joseph puts them through a series of tests to make sure they're honest, to make sure they're walking in integrity. One of them involves his brother. You should read it. It's really good. But the point I want to make to you is, Joseph had been sold into slavery. Everything that he went through was because somebody who was close to him had hurt him. But by the time he had gotten to the place where God called him to, his brothers were coming in. His brothers were nervous because, see, here's the crazy thing about this now. Now Joseph is in a place where now he has the upper hand. And see, the real proof of whether you're right with God or not is going to be, sooner or later, God is going to put the people who hurt you in your hands. And a sign of whether you're right with God or not is you're going to have the ability to get revenge. Whether you take it or not shows you where you are with God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Sooner or later, the very people who hurt you are going to be vulnerable for you. And how you treat them is going to be a sign of your relationship with God. I'm going to say this again, so that way you hear what I'm saying, because it's coming for some of you. Some of the very people who hurt you, who you thought or they thought they left you for dead, some of those same people are going to need you. And by the time they need you, you're going to be in a place where you can extract all the revenge you want. You can do whatever you want to do to them. The real proof of your anointing with God is, what do you do when the tables are turned and now you have the ability to do them the same way they did you, if not worse? I don't know why, but I feel in my spirit I need to say this one more time. Some of the same people who abused you are going to need you soon. But I'm going to tell you what happened. Joseph asked this question to his brothers. He says, don't be afraid. He says, don't be afraid. He asked a question. He says, is my father still alive? And then he goes on to tell his brothers. He says, then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? But his brothers could not answer him. See, because they were without words. They couldn't talk now. And he says, and Joseph said to his brothers, please come near me. So they came near, and they said, he said, I am Joseph. I'm your brother whom you sold into Egypt. But now, do not therefore grieve or be angry with yourselves because you sold me out here. Watch this. For God sent me ahead of you to preserve your life. I need you to catch that statement. If you catch that statement, it will deliver you from a lot of bitterness. He says, God sent me here ahead of you to preserve your life. Everything that he had went through, See, because here's the thing. If Joseph had gotten the dream without God, and I'm almost done. If Joseph had gotten the dream without God, guess what would have happened? He would have made it more about him than about the thing. And by the way, sometimes God, by the time he realized this, all the pain, what all the pain was for, by the time he realized it, he was already in a place now. I want you to look. See, she can't bring her glasses. Sometimes God will put you in a place. Now I need you to hear this. Listen, because I believe this is for you too. Sometimes all the pain you go through in life, all the things that you go through that you don't tell anybody about, all the sad times you had, all the bad times you had, all the times you got frustrated, everything that goes on, everything that hurts you, all that sort of stuff, is for no other reason than for God to make you a gift to a group of people. See, now you know that you can go through something and you can survive it. And God is going to use the pain and the hurt and the tears that you've gone through, baby girl, to make you a gift to a group of people. And one day you're going to be a leader. I believe with the moment I first laid my eyes on you, when you asked me if I wanted to play when you was a little girl, I said, this little girl is going to lead people. And see, she even came to me and she said, you're going to do something today. God was giving her insight. And she said, I want to help you do it. We were in the back. But I'm telling you, God had this whole thing lined up for you. One day you're going to be a leader and you're going to lead men and women. God is using this to show you that even though you've gone through things, and sometimes you may not even think you're worthy of it, God says you're special and you're my creation. God had your whole life mapped out. And he's going to take you through stuff. And he's going to use your life to make you a gift to a group of people. Do you hear me? You're a leader. And you're special. And you're special. Listen. I don't know who we're talking to, who we're preaching to, me and my deputy preacher. But God has a plan for your life. And I know it may sound cliche-ish, but God led her through all this stuff because he wanted to put her on display. So, because he wanted that when she opened her mouth and spoke to people, stuff would come out that would change lives and change destiny. All the stuff you've been through, baby, you can speak to somebody in 30 seconds and watch them be delivered, watch them set free. Yeah. See, because now you have the gift of understanding. You have the gift where you can speak and declare a thing and it'll be so. Mm-hmm. See, because nobody got to tell you that God can't keep you because you know that God will keep you. Mm-hmm. See, some of us, many of us in this room, if not all of us, ain't nobody got to tell you God can keep you because you know God can keep you. Mm-hmm. Because you've already been through the fire. And sometimes God had to do that. Amen? We did. You okay with being a leader? You are? Okay, so we're going to help you, okay? We got you. So you just got to find out what you're going to be and what you're going to lead me in. We're going to hook that up, okay? You going to be a congresswoman as well? You don't know yet? Okay, so we're going to work all that out. But listen, I want you to stand. Listen, sometimes, I love you. She is so cute. Her and her sister, they are all my kids are so adorable. But listen, there's a king in you. There's a queen in you. Sometimes you go through a lot of stuff. But God said there's a purpose in your pain. And I don't know who I'm talking to in this room, but there's some things that you're going through right now that you may have thought you would have never gotten through. But God says there's purpose behind the things I allow. So I don't know who you are. I don't know. what's going on, but if there's an area in your life right now where you seem to be going through some things and you need prayer, I want you to come to the altar. We won't have you up here. I want you to come to the altar. We want to begin to pray for you. There's an area in your life where you need prayer.